Hare Krishna. So we continue. So this was from Chaitanya Charitamrita, and Prabhupada is explaining of all regulatory principles, the spirit and master's order to chant at least 16 rounds is most essential. And so if one asks this question, what is the goal of chanting? What do you think about that? What do you say about that? What is actually the goal?
Remember Krishna.
Yes, but even something more.
Relationship,
yes. And that means love for Krishna. So that's actually the highest perfection is to develop love, pure love, prema bhakti for Krishna. And so what is actually love? In the Chaitanya Charitamrita, it's explained about the difference between lust and love. It gives like a definition, and I can show you here. It's in Adi Lila 464 and 465. It's Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, and he gives a very clear definition. What is actually love and what is lust? What is the difference? So you can see here. If we chant together, Kama prema dona kara vibhina lakshana laula arahe mayachesvarupe vilakshana. Varuna Prabhu, can you read? If you read.
Okay, English. Lust and love have different characteristics, just as iron and gold have different natures.
So gold and iron, completely different nature. So in the similar way, also prema, pure love, and lust. And then the second verse here, at mendriya priti vancha tare bala kama krishnendriya priti icha tare prema nama. Prabhu.
The desire to gratify one's own senses is kama, lust. The desire to please the senses of Lord Krishna is prema.
So it's very clear. If one desires to please Krishna's senses, that's love or prema. And as soon as one tries to satisfy one's own senses, then that is actually lust. So this japa, Satchinandana Swami, he said something I think profound, and he said that japa is, it's not a ritual, japa is a relationship. So Krishna is not different from his name, Krishna is present directly in his name. So when we say, when we chant the holy name, we directly come in contact with the Lord. And Prabhupada gave the example with water. If you say, if you're very thirsty and then you say water, 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 so it never shrinks a thirst, because it's a difference between the sound water and the substance water. So, but when you chant Krishna's name, there is no difference. So it's a relationship, and I think we all have experience of it easily turns into something ritualistic when we chant. That we make it like not with the heart, not completely with full attention. And when we don't do that, it tends to become more like a ritual, ritualistic. We're thinking about many other things. But this can just the simple thing, japa is not a ritual, it's a relationship. We want to establish a relationship. Just like in an ordinary world, if we want to have a relationship, it's something very personal. And you have to pay your attention to the person. If you don't focus on the person, then it's actually you feel offended. If you are absent-minded when you speak with someone, then you naturally feel this person doesn't take me seriously. And you feel hurt or sad about this situation because we want full attention in a relationship. So this is also, we should remember with the holy name, it's a relationship. And the more we try to establish that relationship by the spirit in the chanting, we will also see how Krishna is reciprocating with that. So now I want to say something, some practical things about before we start our japa. So one can speak about two things, which is I found it's very helpful. And number one is, you see here, to make a conscious shift in our consciousness. Conscious shift. Because I think we all experience in our lives so many things are going on many, many different levels, isn't it? We have so many duties, so many obligations, so many things that are in our mind. But when, before we chant Hare Krishna, before we chant our japa, if we can make that conscious shift, that now it's japa time, and all these things, which is also important, which I have to deal with, that they will not disappear, they will still be there, but now, for this short time, I just put them aside. So that's, and like you see here, like a switch, electric switch. You just, okay, now you turn your material life just off for some time. So that's something very practical. And it's not easy, of course, we know it's very difficult, but if we are more conscious and we are fixed in that determination, it really helps. So number two, it's focus. So focus is it's very closely connected, this to turn everything off and to focus. So when we chant the holy name, if the more we are focused, we pay full attention to the name, we will see amazing difference in our life and in our consciousness. So it's interesting to see that we actually have experience that we can be focused in our life. It's not something we don't do, we just pay focus on many different things. You see here, for instance, if you are in school and you're preparing for an exam, you're very focused, especially if you have a higher goal, you want to get a good grade. So you are very focused in your preparation, and also at the time of the exam, you are very, very focused. So it's possible to be focused. Or when we're speaking to someone, as we spoke about, that if you're focused, we can be focused. If there's something very important, you speak with another person about something really important or something coming from the heart, it really means a lot to you, what you're speaking about, you are completely focused. You don't think about other things. So we can do it. Or example, if you have a work, for instance, as a judge, very big responsibility. So you have to be completely focused to understand what is right and wrong here and make the right judgment. Or when people are watching movies, they can just forget everything around them. I think we all have that experience. Sometimes there is a movie which is, your feelings become very strong, and you feel so much, you get drawn into the action, or you get scared, and so many things. So this focus, it's there. sometimes like complete focus. Or in sports, of course, people are very, very focused in order to obtain good results. Or in music, those who are playing really good music, they are so focused. So this is just examples. Or surgeon, when there is an important operation, so it's so focused. Or archery, like that. Or sports, when there is a short distance, I think this is 100 meters they're running, and the start is so important. So they are like preparing for being focused, and then the start gun goes off and you just start to run. So it says here that if we do not pay attention, we won't get the benefit. I think we all have experience when we read something, like for instance if we read a book, and sometimes we can read a whole page and we are not paying attention to actually what we are reading. We are somewhere else. And when we do that, we will experience we don't get the benefit. And something similar like that, one can say, offensive chanting is like that. We don't get the benefit. So it's so important to be focused in our japa, in our chanting. So these two things, to make a conscious shift and to have focus, that can make a big difference in our life. You have any reflection on this so far? Some thoughts, some of your own experience about this?
Yeah,
it's very, very difficult.
Yeah, very difficult. I don't know, maybe in my chanting, maybe one or two times maybe I am able to focus, and the rest of the time I'm doing it, but I have many thoughts in my mind.
Once Satsvarup Maharaj, he asked Prabhupada, how can I quickly make advancement in spiritual life? And then Prabhupada said, if you think this is the last day in your life, that tonight I will die, I will leave my body, so how would you chant then? How would you serve then? How would your attitude be if you know it's just a few hours left? So that can help us. So the point we made is that when it's really a very important situation, we can focus. So when death is coming close, we can actually take shelter of the Holy Name, because we realize there is no other shelter. So that's the mode in the chanting. Krishna is our only shelter. So it's like you said, it's not easy. We all, I guess, we're struggling with this, no doubt. But at the same time, you, by being conscious and together with devotees speak about it, because as Prabhupada said, it's the most important thing, the most important service in our devotional life. So if it's the most important thing, that's where we should pay full attention. But when we discuss it with other devotees, and then we can develop a desire to try to improve. And that can help. So, but the tendency, as we spoke about in the beginning, it becomes ritualistic. You just do it and you are absent-minded. And then we also naturally lose the taste, and easily also, to different degrees, lose the faith in the Holy Name. It's like when you take a medicine and you don't take the medicine in the proper way, you don't get the right effect. And then actually you start to doubt the medicine. What's this? I don't see the effect. So you think this medicine is useless. But actually you took it, you didn't take it in the proper way, according to the doctor's description. So in the same way or a similar way, we can say with the holy name. So it's a challenge, but we can also, by just trying, we can see positive results. And that's encouraging, because we want to make progress. Every one of us want to make progress in spiritual life. We want to become more advanced. So if we see some results that actually be advancing, that's very encouraging. Something else? Yes?
In the start we heard that Prabhupada was saying that we should always remember Krishna. That means basically, in a sense, we chant only, more or less like, for example, for us, Prabhupada has made a set of that 2 hours of chanting and then there is a services. But the thing is now that when I was just thinking about, when I was hearing in the class that, let's say, for us it's practically problem about conscious shift is because the rest of the day we are in a material consciousness where we have to deal with the, practically we are dealing with materialistic people, and also there is no rarely devotee association, because you know all are busy with lot of things are happening, you know, around us. So what if there is a devic varnashram established where that Krishna is established first and then the varnashram is established, where we have an example, for example, in Almuk's Ghat, I don't say like a full but devic varnashram, but some kind of, we can see a reflection of devic varnashram established. So I was just thinking that if the devic varnashram is established full-fledged, then this problem of conscious shifting will be much reduced, you know, it will be much, how do you say,
easier.
I mean, it will be much easier, you know. Then we don't, because then the consciousness will be fully, more or less, all the time with Krishna. Because in the devic varnashram, everyone is working directly or indirectly, and the goal is for Krishna. You know? But of course, I understand that now, where we are. And for us, the situation is that we are being surrounded by, we are in conditioned state now. So. So of course, you know, then the thing is that what we can do is then the best thing what we can do is have a devotee association more and more, and in that association the easiest way is to have about remembering Krishna always like that, and of course then the focus is that the goal is that we want to achieve Krishna's love. So so I was just thinking that how devic varnashram can assist us in focusing and bringing our consciousness more to Krishna.
It's like you said, if you are associating with non-devotees, big part of the day, maybe you have these different duties, so it's undoubtedly a challenge, and it would be more easy if you said like Daivyat Varnashram is established and you have this culture, this support from society to become more and more spiritual advanced. So, but also one can remember that Krishna sees our situation. So when we are in a difficult situation with association which is not like uplifting or inspiring for our spiritual life, Krishna is also appreciating our struggle, and we get a lot of mercy by struggling. It's not only that we should have an easy day or easy task, but for a higher purpose of benefiting others, we can please Krishna, and then our chanting, our japa, will become more and more deep. Like in ordinary life, if you are working, for instance, one can meditate about how some or other, how can I reach the heart of someone that just have that desire. If I now chant more sincerely japa, maybe Krishna is arranging that someone who has a little interest for something deeper will show up. Or you get opportunities to distribute prasadam or books and like that. So in whatever situation we are in, there will be challenges, difficulties. But these difficulties and challenges are actually opportunities for us to become more purified and to get Krishna's blessings, mercy. Like Prabhupada, he was sending out very early devotees to different parts of the world. Devotees he has been in the movement for a few months. Like in the beginning, some of the new devotees, they became temple presidents after 3 months, 4 months, 5 months. Big responsibilities. And Prabhupada said, go this, to that country. And I know it was fun. Devotee who Prabhupada wanted to go to South Africa. I think he was 18 years old. And he went with a couple of other devotees. But some or other, they disappeared. So he was alone in South Africa, 18 years old, completely new devotee. Prabhupada just wanted him to stay. So great challenges, but so much mercy. Prabhupada is appreciating, Gaunitā is appreciating when we struggle. And especially if we think about not only our own spiritual life, but how can we benefit others? What do you think about that?
Yeah, I agree with that, that this is our condition, what it is, but and we try to do the best, and that, of course, elevates us. In, but the thing is also that, like, sometimes we also have to do material adjustments, which we can do in our life, which can lead us more towards, you know, a better Krishna conscious platform, instead of, you know, struggling again and again, and, you know, being, I mean, knowing that this will not improve our spiritual life, and then even though sometimes we have seen that devotees have a possibility to do some adjustment in their life in a way that this will make their life more towards Krishna consciousness.
Right? Mm.
So I was just thinking that, I mean, we should not forget that also that if there is a possibility to make an adjustment, that then we can make an adjustment in our life, and which can lead us more. I'm not saying like a full, like just surrendering, like for example, like Prabhupada's instruction about some devotees were going to South Africa. I'm not saying that kind of adjustment, but at least some basic adjustment in our life we can make, that which will lead us more towards, you know, more devotee association, and we can reduce our, you know, association with materialistic people less and less. So
that's why the japa is so important, because that gives us the inspiration and strength. And Krishna is also arranging in our lives so many opportunities when the japa becomes more deep. So we need it desperately, everyone. And to discuss it among the devotees, with this which is most important, our that help us to become more eager, more inspired to make advancement. So we are all on different levels, and from whatever level we are at now, maybe some of you are chanting 1 round or 3 rounds or 10 rounds or 16 rounds, but on whatever level we are now, from that point we should just try to improve and make progress. And if we start to make progress from whatever point we are now, that's success.
Yeah, as long as we are progressing. Yes.
Yes. So, I asked for our inspiration. I found a very inspiring verse. It's from the Kali Santarana Upanishad. It's a conversation that took place just in the beginning of Kali Yuga, approximately 5,000 years ago, between this combination between Narada Muni and Lord Brahma. And Narada is asking this question. He feels compassion. Narada is understanding how much people are suffering in Kali Yuga, and he also sees the future, they will suffer even more. So he asks his question to Brahma, how can the fallen souls be liberated in Kali Yuga? And so then the answer, can you please read?
This is the secret of all the Vedic scriptures which help you to cross the medieval ocean of the Kali Yuga simply through the chanting of the name of Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayan. Men are purified in this age of Kali.
Hmm. So it's a miserable ocean, Kali Yuga. But Lord Brahma is speaking here about the holy name. And then Narada asks which names it is. He mentioned Narayan, but more specifically, then Lord Brahma, he's reciting the Maha Mantra. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And then it continues.
Still myself.
Yeah, please.
These 16 names composed of 32 syllables are the only means to counteract the destructive influence of Kali Yuga.
It's the only means to counteract this destructive influence. Evocation?
After having studied the Vedas, we cannot find a method of religion more appropriate for this age than chanting the Hare Krishna.
What does that mean? Destroying the gross and subtle coverings of the jiva, the Maha Mantra.
I know, false ego and mind. Because the gross body is mind, and the subtle is, or the subtle is mind, and gross body is false ego.
Hmm.
Or I don't.
But destroys it. Well, we still have our bodies here, it's not destroyed, we're chanting Hare Krishna.
Our identifying with the body.
Yeah. The identification, and we are not in the future bound to take another birth. So in this way, it destroys the gross and subtle material coverings of the jiva. So the subtle coverings, like you said, false ego, and we think that we are meant to be the enjoyers, and we will actually be able to become successful to enjoy this material world. And then the final line here, Philip.
Then the Supreme Lord will appear in front of him as the brilliant beams of the sun after the clouds are dispelled.
Hmm. So Krishna appears like that, just like the sun. So now something about building the foundation. So if this is the most important thing in our life, the foundation. So to build our life on this foundation is most important. Everything is based on the foundation. Like if you build a house, the foundation is the basis of everything. Actually, Lord Jesus, he spoke about this, that we should not build our house on sand, we should build it on rock. And this is from the Bible, just one quote here. You see a house built on sand, and So Jesus, he says, Mayursaki, can you read?
The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash.
And then Jesus continues. You read that too?
The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock.
So that's Jesus' words. So the japa is a foundation in our life. Everything auspicious will come from chanting. So now something just short about evaluating our japa, to reflect on our japa, and regularly monitor the quality of japa by considering, now it's three things. What is going well, what isn't going well, and how can we improve? So it can be very helpful if we just reflect on it. Like we said, it tendencies becomes ritualistic, it goes just in a similar way day after day. But if we stop and reflect and just think, how was my japa today? And how can I improve? What was going well, what was not going well? And like this morning, I can just say for myself, I was really determined for different reasons from the very beginning, from the first mantra, now I should be focused. And it was not easy, but I was struggling, and I could really feel the effect of it. So the day before, I was not doing it. So I was reflecting on that. Now I really have to try to change here. So what isn't going well, and how to just try to improve. I found it very beneficial to just reflect for myself about my japa. Do you do that sometimes? You have some experience? So we can do it more consciously and just in this way improve. And a little improvement over time amount major progress. So that's important statement, that if we just try a little bit for improvement, for over a long period of time, it can have a great effect, big, big effect. So we think maybe it's insignificant, I really try now to improve, I'm struggling, not so much is happening, but over a long period of time, we will see how life actually changes. So that can be an inspiration. And like here, about japa today, excellent, very good, good, average, or poor. Just for our...
How do we measure that?
Well, we have to be critical and just think about honestly, how was it actually today? And also by discussing it among the devotees, how to improve, we become more aware of this. And we don't,
But how do you know what is good japa and what is bad japa?
Generally, we see it by the effect it has on our consciousness. That when we chant good japa, then the consciousness becomes clear, we become peaceful, we become enthusiastic, determined, happy in our lives. That's some effect.
Like maybe one thing is that it's like chanting is like serving the Lord or like holy name. So so when the chanting has been proper, I mean, for example, in my case, I will not judge that instead, because that might bring an attachment. But in a sense that it will be that if the chanting has been proper, then our start has been. we are more focused in Krishna consciousness the whole day. And if it is not, that means our chanting has not been proper. So that could be one way of judging that, for example, are we able to focus on our service in Krishna consciousness well for the whole day? Like it can be practically meeting with relatives and talking with someone, or you know, serving directly. So that could be one way to check for us that whether our preparation for the day with chanting has been nice or not.
Thank you.
I know, that could be one.
My experience is also, especially in relationships, you see the reflection, how you actually reach to the other person, more like from heart to heart, and you become more tolerant, patient, and you see more the good qualities in others, not so much finding fault and like that. So that's practical effects of better chanting. And when they chant poor, then in the relationships we can experience it. You also have experience of that?
Result gives the measure.
Yeah. So we are persons, Krishna is a supreme person, but we also relate to so many people, and also in professional life, if you are at work with non-devotees, and how you can relate to people in a good spirit, and they will see your good qualities, they will appreciate, and it's also a way to reach people, and you will not be very affected by if someone is a little harsh or agitated or angry or disturbed, like you can take it more in a little more transcendental way. So it's very practical in our life. We directly can experience the difference in our consciousness. And so that's why japa is a foundation for everything we are doing. Everything is built on that. So we should build it on rock, not on sand. Any more reflections on this? Yes?
Krishna doesn't judge anybody. Why should we judge that our japa is good?
Oh, I couldn't hear now.
Krishna doesn't judge anybody.
Narada didn't judge anybody.
Krishna
doesn't judge.
Why should we judge if our japa is good or bad?
Krishna doesn't judge anyone. Krishna is a well-wisher, the best friend of everyone. So why should we judge our own japa? Because we want to please Krishna by our japa. We want to improve. And if we improve and we struggle to improve, that pleases Krishna. So our goal should be like that. In all our activities, we just try to please Krishna, Prabhupada and Guru and Krishna. So we should struggle for that. And then we have to judge, also see, so we can also see if we're making progress, coming closer to Krishna. And that struggle is pleasing to Krishna. What do you think about that?
It's fine that we are pleasing Krishna, it's absolutely fine, but I'm agreeing with Mataji, you said ki how should we judge ourselves, it's good, excellent, you know. We might think that it's good, but it might not be good, so that uncertainty of knowing what is good japa, what is bad, that is something still difficult to judge.
When you speak like Krishna doesn't judge anyone, that is one thing, to judge somebody. But then to judge your japa, you're not judging anyone.
Evaluating.
It's more evaluating. Yeah, so you're using the same word but in two different meanings. We understand that Krishna doesn't judge. His judgment means more like you have some prejudice against the person. So yes, Krishna doesn't have any prejudice because it's in our heart, he knows about us. But then for us to estimate or evaluate the japa, that's another thing.
I would like to add something like that in order what you're saying about judging or not, but evaluating. And it's good, as Prabhu say, because why shouldn't we evaluate our japa? It's like when we go in the university and we do an exam and we only get 50 marks out of 100, then we are evaluating what could I have done better. So you always want to strive for the highest mark, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So the same thing with the japa, you want to improve your japa to please Krishna. That is how we should think, like to improve it more and more every day. That is what I want to do.
Okay.
Just one thing, like I don't know if it was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that you know, he was crying that I could not get attraction to the holy name of the Lord, even for Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So even though, I mean, it could be that one is judging or not, I don't know, but he should always think that his chanting is almost at the lowest level of, you know, that he has not attained any attraction. Otherwise, if one thinks that, you know, is excellent today and chanting, you know, then he will never progress from that stage of, you know.
Hmm.
So, as a mood of humbleness, then one should always think that he has still not got any attraction for the Lord's holy name, as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is teaching us with that. And then when it comes to the fault finding, I was thinking more like a deviation. There's a difference between fault finding and deviation finding. So, for example, in the Shastra, there is said about chastising. For example, guru chastises the disciple, the husband can chastise the wife in the sense of Shastra. So sometimes, you know, we make a mistake between fault and deviation, you know. So it could be that someone is trying to find a deviation if he is authorized. For example, a guru finds a deviation that this is not true for a disciple, then it has to be taken in a good sense, you know. So that I was just thinking that it's good that we are aware of that, who can, if the deviation is within Shastra, Guru Shastra, Guru Sadhu and Shastra, then we should accept that and understand what is right. And, so that was just a reflection, I thought that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It's true that the more we advance in spiritual life, we feel that actually I am unqualified, or I'm even low, I'm very fallen. So that's a wonderful quality of a pure devotee. Like we see with Prabhupada, he was expressing his, in different circumstances, his fallen position. And he was giving the credit to his disciples, and he said that my disciples, they are sent by my Guru Maharaj just to assist me. So this complete humility like that. But then also Prabhupada, he was a guru, means was a heavy. Like you said, if you see deviations, if you see, then it's your duty to point that out and so rectify it. And that's, if one doesn't do it, then one is actually making aparad. Because if people are not following in the proper way, that's harming for their progress. So it's a delicate thing. But in general, I think we should experience this, that when we're chanting better round, that we will actually improve in quality in our lives. And we need that that inspiration to feel that we're going forward. But then at the same time, the more we advance, we also become more humble and appreciate others. But this fault finding is very destructive, so it's important to understand the difference between fault finding and correcting according to what is actually proper according to our philosophy. Okay. So there are three stages of chanting, and Namaparad, offensive chanting, Namabhas, the clearing stage of chanting, and Shudanam, the pure stage of chanting. And so now something about trying to improve. So, can you please read?
Without making a regular effort to improve, our japa can easily lapse into a mediocre state.
So this struggle for improvement is so important. Juliana?
If we are not trying to regularly improve, it can easily get worse.
So it's like a law of nature, like if you are swimming upstream and if you're not struggling to move forward, you just become a little slowing down, then the tendency is you start to go backwards.
Where this verse is taken, is that from the purport or the last, this two, is it taken from Prabhupada's book or the purport?
Not exactly, but this is collection from different devotees who spoke about japa and the holy name, and it's Prabhupada and it's sometimes also...
Yeah, because I was just thinking about the next... yeah, it makes sense, but I was just wanted to... correlate with if there is any verse or if there is any purport taken this from this. Okay, no problem.
If you ask this question, what's the difference between offensive chanting and the cleaning stage? Can you please read?
The difference between offensive chanting and the clearing stage is the effort you make to improve. When you make your best efforts, you are at least on clearing stage.
Giriraj Maharaj, he once asked Prabhupada about his japa, and he said that I'm struggling with my mind, thinking about so many other things. Giriraj Maharaj, he got so many responsibilities from Prabhupada, and he asked, is this all offensive? And then Prabhupada asked him a question back, and he said, are you trying? Are you really trying to be focused? And Giriraj Maharaj, he thought, and then he said, yes, I'm trying. And then Prabhupada said, then it's not offensive. So that's the difference between Namaparad and Namabhas platform. This struggle, we really try our best. But when we give after for so many things going on in the mind, then we're actually on the Namaparad platform. So we should be very careful to get up from that stage. So now something about habits. Since we are creatures of habit, we have specific japa habits.
Improving japa entails creating new and improved japa habits, thus making good japa our norm.
So that's the goal, to get it, good japa. Our norm, normally. So how to develop good habit? I heard Vaisheshika Prabhu, he gave this example that if you have a thin thread and it's hardly visible, and every day you're adding another thread, then like that, in due course of time, you see here big rope. Just every day adding, it will become like unbreakable. So that's the habit power of developing good habit. So I find it helpful for myself to like think about the weeks, that this week I will try to really make a difference. One can do it mantra by mantra, day by day, but also 1 week and reflect a little about how was this week. This week work on overcoming some bad japa habits by developing some new and better habits. And one can reflect on it in the mind, but one can also write down different realizations like that.
Note that all realizations will not necessarily be positive. Sometimes you might simply realize how difficult it is to change.
These kind of realizations make you aware that you will have to work harder at improving than you might have thought.
I think we can relate to that, and it's not easy.
Therefore, even the bad becomes an inspiration to improve.
Then we come into a second part here. Do you have any reflection on this last part?
So the last slide was quite fast. I wanted to just little bit ponder about that, those three things. Exactly, you know, to go deeper and understand what exactly is. Especially the last line, you know. Therefore, when the bad becomes good, what do you mean? What does that exactly say here? That even any person can become an inspiration, or kind of a bad realization, or what does it?
I gave the example from my own japa, the day before, or yesterday. I was not attentive in the beginning. It took a few rounds, and I reflected on that. So some bad, like experience from that, and now today, I because I was reflecting on it, I got that determination. I really want to make a difference today. So that's one example how it helped one to, even the bad can help you to become inspired. Now I will really try to change and come to a higher level.
And just from the thing is, Prabhu, that sometimes we know, let's say that I guess many of you already know that, okay, this is kind of a bad for my chanting, for example, you know, that my mind is spaced out, or some, just an example that. So the thing is that sometimes that kind of enthusiasm doesn't come when person is, you know, sitting alone, and you know, it's hard. Sometimes it could come, you know. I mean, of course, it depends on your endeavor, but when a person is in devotee association, for example, or let's say, you know, is regular devotee association, or then it's much easy to overcome this kind of bad habits, I can say like that, or offensive chanting. So yeah, I mean, it all depends on again enthusiasm, how how a person takes. So, but again, devotee association can give us much easier process by which we can go to anartha nivritti, you know, where we can get our anarthas out of our heart.
We have a good solution for that.
Yeah.
You just come to the morning japa on the WhatsApp. Dimitri is always there. And I travel so much, Dimitri. Sometimes I can be there, sometimes not. But when I'm there, it's a big difference in my japa.
Hmm.
Because when you chant with other devotees, then it's like you have to be shaped up. Somehow, isn't it?
Yeah.
You can't, because you feel that other devotee will feel that you are spaced out. So then you have to like, no. Now I have to be, I have to be good. Yeah.
Mm.
It's a big difference for the whole day when it's set.
What time you have it?
Between 5 and 7.
5 and 7. Oh. And how many usually attend?
Nowadays, 3.
3.
Sometimes maybe 4.
Yeah.
Mm. So you're just sitting and you're chanting?
Yeah, we just sit down and just chant.
So you have good experience from that?
Very good.
Very good experience. Yeah. Mm. I can also tell experience from Anvik that lately it's very auspicious because many devotees are coming from Mangalarti and many of the youth are coming from Mangalarti. So we have quite some teenagers there. And then we have japa period after that in the temple. And it becomes very powerful. Also, I am speaking with different devotees about japa like this in Anvik. Some are completely new in Krishna consciousness. Then we also have a group of older devotees like Janamalaya Prabhu, Haristha Prabhu, Prabhupada disciples, and Ishwari, who also met Prabhupada, and Dharani, Lakshmi, and a few others. And we also meet and we speak about japa. And by just speaking, not only chanting, but speaking about that realizations and difficulties and challenges, that also helps to improve, to develop a desire to improve. Because I'm thinking we are a preaching movement, and the more as a group we become strong and inspired and can support each other, then the preaching will be so much more effective. So it's like a responsibility to discuss and speak about that which is the most important thing. And that's how to improve our japa.
Then one of the 6 loving exchanges between devotees, and this is one is about opening our heart to the other, and that definitely makes a difference. For example, recently we were in 4 days in Gothenburg, and we found out that when
you were in Gothenburg 4 days,
so Vatapas Prabhu and all other devotees were there.
Hmm.
So we found out that it was a big difference when you are within the devotees and when you reveal your heart, and you know, like in the sense that to improve your devotional service, or it makes a difference, at least what we got realized. So, so yes, that is absolutely very, very needful and useful for us.
Jai.
I have a question. What if someone does offensive chanting, but thinks as if it is a good chanting and there is no need of improvement? Then how, in that situation, how to you know, because that person thinks that there is no 100, the 50 is only 100, the marks. So how to show that there is 100 also,
It's also depending on your relationship with that devotee, according to the Vaishnava etiquette also, that if you should approach someone who who is senior like that, then you better approach another devotee and say, I just become aware that this is not, this devotee is not paying proper attention or pronouncing the Maha Mantra correctly and like that. And maybe you please can try to tell that devotee. But if you have a friend, if you are on an equal like level, then you can just say it as a friend, as a well-wisher. And or if there is someone more new, you do it with just affection and care and like that. So it can be a sensitive thing sometimes. Sometimes I'm recording myself just to hear my own voice chanting, and sometimes I get surprised that I thought it was pronouncing it the whole mantra, but when I hear it, it's missing one rama there or something like that. So that's also a good thing. Yeah, it can so easily happen. So one has to constantly work on it and try to support each other, inspire each other. So now this is Prabhupada hand with the beads there. Important japa in the practice of bhakti. So the following statements explain the importance of japa in bhakti. Jelena?
The initial letters is common for Srila Prabhupada to write that chanting 60 rounds is our ticket back to Godhead.
So it's like a ticket. And it's Prabhupada actually said that if you chant 16 rounds, you follow the four regular principles, I promise I will take you back to Godhead. Promise. So that's amazing.
I have a short question. What is most important if we chant 10 rounds, like in the beginning, if we are the beginner? 10 rounds without offense or 16 rounds which are not so good? Offensive and not so attentive.
Like I said before, on whatever level we are now, the perfection is we try to improve and gradually come to that level that we can chant 16 rounds because Prabhupada set that number as a minimum. So that's very, very powerful if we can. It's very pleasing to Prabhupada. So then to your question, so we should just work on the quality very seriously. Really try to do it with quality. So if you have vowed, if you are initiated to chant 16 rounds, you should chant 16 rounds. That's the vow. But then we should also really work on the quality at the same time. Is that okay?
Don't you get more quality with quantity?
More quality with quantity?
The more you chant and try it, then the more possibility that you will be able to concentrate. Maybe it takes you 10 rounds to just calm down the mind, and then the 6 last may be the good ones. What do you think about that?
So the it has to be a balance there. Sometimes devotees, I've seen, they get into that mode, they will chant a lot of extra rounds for becoming more purified and advancing. But sometimes it's not recommended. It depends. So there are, in the Nectar of Devotion, it's explained about 64 items. That is very important, but 5 is most important. And that's, do you know which they are, the 5?
Chanting
chanting the holy name.
Yeah.
To stay in the holy town, to worship Tulasi. I think that's in connection with associating with devotees and read the Srimad Bhagavatam.
First is Sadhu Sangha, associating with the devotee, Nama Kirtan, chanting of the holy name, Japa or Kirtan, Bhagavata Shravanam, to hear the Bhagavatam, discussing Bhagavatam, Mathura Vasa, to live in a holy place like Mathura, or this is also a holy place in Lund here, the temple, Govindas, like that. And worshipping the deity with the love and devotion, these five. So there should be some balance there. Prabhupada created the morning program with all these items is there. So sometimes it gets out of balance. So it should be, you should have all these things. And each of them support also our japa, our development, like that. Like one devotee, when Prabhupada was present, he asked for the blessing that he could just go to Mayapur and chant, sitting in one place and chant. And Prabhupada was not in favor of it, but he was very determined, so he said okay. And he did it for a few months and then he left. And devotees saw him later on that he was working in a petrol station, tanking up cars. So one has to get that balance. That's another aspect of it.
Too hard for them because 64 rounds takes like about 8 hours. And then he decreased to 32, but still devotees were too slow in doing their service and so on and so on. But I'm reflecting upon that. I myself have that experience after that. I came up to 16 rounds and so on, that I've tried it a couple of times to actually like chant 16 rounds, and then I could go for 16 more rounds and chanted 32 rounds. And I see the effect of the mind, how the more rounds you chant, if you feel that eagerness to increase your rounds, then the mind is like more and more peaceful. But and only a few times I've tried to, like for a Janmashtami and Gopurnima, try to chant 64 rounds. And the more you chant those days, auspicious days, then you will also feel the effect how the mind will gradually enter into another mood. And that is also helpful. Like that's the medicine actually. So you shouldn't be scared of chanting more. It's actually good because that's what we want. Mantra to liberate mind from this material bondage and identification. That's my experience.
Yeah, on special days, definitely it's very beneficial and recommended. One should chant extra rounds and hear and chant more in general. But we are all individuals, we are in a unique situation, and we have different responsibilities. So whatever is also possible, and for also us to be able to maintain. I've seen so many devotees coming and going, and it's not easy to maintain. So in order to maintain it, there has to also be good balance. And I saw one devotee he didn't have good relationship with the devotees. And because of different reasons, became a little lonely, and he was just chanting and chanting and chanting, like some kind of compensation because something was not cleared out. So then, that's just one example that one has to also deal with one's unique situation. How can I here, from the point where I'm at, make progress? So, like my son told me the other day, his realization that when he's chanting, he said that I sometimes think that when I'm in the temple and I'm chanting japa, I'm looking at a certain painting on the wall and I'm focused on that, and it really gives me inspiration like anything. And then I think next day it will be the same. I do the same thing, but it doesn't happen like that. So it's not like something mechanical. Krishna is like really trying in a very personal way to help us to make progress. And if we think it's something mechanical or ritualistic, we just do it like this, we sit like this straight, or we have this different kind of external things that we think will help. So that we can see Krishna is not, you cannot capture Krishna like that. So one must be ready to adjust, and also to have this feedback from devotees. It's so important. And one has guru, shiksha gurus, mentors, and like that. One can, what do you think about my situation here now, and get some feedback. So it's one can see it from many different angles, isn't it? Well, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree. And as you say, it depends on what level in life you are at, family status. If you have children and family and everything else, then of course it's difficult. But if you don't have, of course you can increase.
Hmm.
Chaitanya Swami gave an example of someone who was chanting 64 rounds every day in the temple. And then that person became very offensive to the other devotees because they were not chanting 64. So I think it has to do with one's, how advanced one is, because if one can't maintain it, then better don't do it. You do 16 and then you maintain that. But if you're going to become offensive to devotees, then it makes one is just watering the weeds instead of the bhakti lata. So I think it's has to do with, but then there are devotees who are truly humble, who can actually manage to maintain more rounds.
I think that should be encouraged, but as you said, it's like depends on person to person.
How much they have advanced.
It's so easy that one becomes a little proud. If you're chanting good rounds and you feel I'm getting taste, I really enjoy the chanting, and I see other devotees are struggling, I'm actually better than they, and immediately then you are going down like that. So that's the example of Haridas Thakur. He was chanting 24 hours a day, and he was the most humble person. So sometimes it helps that one really try to please devotees, serve devotees, just being the servant of the servant of the servant, and that will really affect our japa. And just sitting, only sitting, and now I chant more and more and more and more, and this way I will advance. So it's nothing wrong with that, but sometimes you also get stuck there. And you think you are making progress, but others can see that you're a little stuck, actually, and maybe you're a little proud. Others can see that. You don't see it yourself. So it's That's why we need mentors and gurus and good friends, so we can become more aware of what we need for making progress.
Krishna Pratiwanchatarana Prem, you know. So that principle we should always remember when chanting also, that we are serving the holy name, not serving our mind, that we want to make our mind more peaceful, or we want to satisfy our mind so that it can go more towards, you know. I think when we see from the Shastra, then they are pointing more towards serving the holy name instead of serving our mind.
Hmm.
And there is also a reference of Shastra about the parrot chanting, that a parrot can chant 24 hours, but when the death comes, you know, he might not be able to chant that time. So it's more about how you develop Krishna within the heart by serving the holy name, so that, you know, at the end of our life we are able to remember Krishna, or at any stage of life we are able to remember Krishna. So in that sense, following Acharya's, like Prabhupada has designed the whole system in a way that we chant 16 rounds at least, and then we are having other services which we can do, so that you know, the mind doesn't get, you know, too much tired, that okay, only chanting and only one service or this and so. So in that sense, I see that Prabhupada has designed the whole system in a way that we are more elevated, we can be more elevated towards Krishna consciousness platform. So instead of, maybe we may not be just like Haridas Thakur, may not be all of us. So at least we, so that's why Prabhupada see that, and he has given us a simpler way that we can chant minimum 16 rounds. We have other services which we can do, like offering and Tulsi Aarti and Bhagavatam reading and all those. So that can elevate us to
Prabhupada, he said that he founded ISKCON for making possible to have these six loving exchanges between devotees. So I think what is giving us most nourishment and inspiration is when we have good relationship to devotees, loving relationships with devotees. That is like where the real inspiration and energy comes. So, like Prabhupada said, or Rupa Goswami says, to giving gifts and accept gifts and revealing one's mind in confidence, or inquiring confidentially, or serving prasad and accepting prasad. These are the six loving exchanges between the devotees. So when they are like harmonious and flourishing like that, that is so much supporting our japa, inspiration. And when they are not in place, then we can struggle with so many things, but we need that nourishment and association, and also loving relationships. It's quite late. It's 6:10. I have many more things. But we also said we should continue tomorrow in Malmö. So I thought maybe it's a good time to end here. What do you think?
You're all welcome to participate in Malmö. At 3:00 we start with the bhajan. Yes.
Or we will be streaming also. If you can't come, you can just look at it from the Facebook.
So I think just a last word, that we, if as a group tomorrow try to little extra with our japa chanting to become more enthusiastic for taking shelter of the holy name. Prabhupada said it's a prayer, the holy name is a prayer, and one translation Prabhupada said is please engage me in your service, but also another translation Prabhupada mentioned is oh my friend. It's like a prayer, oh my friend Krishna, you are my friend. Or please accept me, Prabhupada also said. Yes, please accept me. So this is the mode that you're praying to the Lord. You are helpless, you are in the ocean of material existence, and it's Kali Yuga, and we really need just please save me. Like that. Shall we try tomorrow?
Yes.
Hare Om. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Okay.